We are live. We're talking about a story about Dana Stevens, and had to cut it short because we are here for you guys. I'm gonna hand the mic over to Mike, so he can introduce the podcast and our guest today.
Okay, sounds good. Hello, all, and welcome to the Brave Sound Podcast. This is the show where we uncover the stories, processes, and worldviews behind some of the most creative and artful musicians. We have a really exciting episode for you guys today with special guest, Mr. Johnathan Blake. So I'll just welcome Johnathan Blake. So I'll just give a short intro of you, if you don't mind. Johnathan Blake, described as the ultimate modernist by John Murph of NPR, is one of the most accomplished drummers of his generation. Yet he has also proven himself to be a complete and endlessly versatile musician. I had the chance to watch Johnathan Blake play at the Jazz Gallery a couple of years ago with his Trion project with Chris Potter and Linda O, as well as at the Village Vanguard with Kenny Barron's group, and especially loved the selfless way he took care of the music and created such a blanket to make everyone's sound blend perfectly. He's had years-long memberships in the Tom Harrell Quintet, the Kenny Barron Trio, and other top ensembles. He's also left a huge imprint on the music of such rising figures in jazz as Alex Sipiagin, Donnie McCaslin, Avishai Cohen, Omer Avital, Jaleel Shaw, and many more. To date, Blake has appeared on over 50 records. We asked Mr. Blake about specific topics he would like to focus on, so our theme for this episode is music as protest, the jazz musician's role in speaking out. Today, our nation is as divided as it's been since the 60s. We're here to give Mr. Blake a platform to speak on the issues important to him and to let us know the changes he wishes to see in our society. So, with no further ado, Mr. Blake, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me, guys. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be here and to chat with you guys both. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, likewise. So, I'd like to start with a question I had in mind about your compositions on your latest record. So you want to discuss quite an intriguing topic of how music can be a means of protest. And I'd love to hear your thoughts as to how music is able to accomplish this. So as I alluded to earlier in the intro, you are by no means just a drummer, but also a really accomplished composer. You have three records out with your last entitled Trion, featuring Chris Potter and Linda O, as I said. Mm-hmm. So when composing the music for Trion, what were some ideas that inspired that record?
There were a lot of different aspects. I think number one was the musicians that I was going to be recording with. Having played quite a bit with Chris and Linda. Chris a little longer because he has of course been in New York longer, but we also started out playing together with the Mingus Big Band in the late 90s. So I was really familiar with how he approached music and his playing and how he's grown over the years as a musician. So I think when I started putting the material together for this particular project, I had his sound in mind, and also Linda O's sound in mind about how they would approach playing the music. And then, with that project, I really wanted to focus on us just really playing, not putting up any kind of barriers for ourselves, and just having that freedom to play, and just go to uncharted territories and see what happens, not having that feeling of being afraid of we're going to mess something up or anything. I just wanted to just go for it and see what happened, and it really exceeded my wildest dreams. So it was just beautiful. I think also the fact that it was a live record, it kind of felt like you were just performing a live gig, so whatever happens, we were in that moment. So to me, it's like I love I grew up listening to lots of live records and also going to see musicians live. You know, my father being a jazz violinist. And so I grew up, you know, from a very early age going to shows and seeing live musicians. And there's just nothing like it. There's a special energy when, you know, you're sharing that space with artists. So, and I think it's, you know, one of the most honest situations you can be in. So for that, it was just really great to have these two amazing artists and not be under the confines of being in a studio with headphones and being able to fix certain things if you mess it up. It was like, no, we're just going to go for it, and whatever happens, happens. And to me, that was the product that came out was like really a result of that honest work that we were putting in on those particular couple nights that we played.
I'm laughing a little bit because, as you're saying, it's a live album recorded at the Jazz Gallery. It's just hitting me that I was there. I didn't realize that was the record. I thought that was the release show for the record, you know. But now that you say that, it's all coming back to me. I was like, oh, I remember this was a live record. I was literally there. it was. So yeah.
Matter of fact, I think we used most of the stuff. Maybe from the second night. I mean, there was a few things from the first night that we used, but I think most of the stuff was from the second night. And the other thing that I should mention was like the some of the music that we bought in, none of us had played before. And I kind of did that on purpose because I didn't want to have like a really preconceived idea about like, you know, how the music should sound and how it should be. It was like, I'm gonna put these tracks in front of you and, you know, let's just see what happens. And you know, that was it. You know, it was just like, all right, you know, let's just go for it.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, it was fun. You know, there was a, you know, it was a couple things where it was just like, oh, okay, this is different. I didn't think this was going to happen and whatever, it just did. So it was, to me, it was just like a representation of really honest music at that point.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting to me that you say you're really trying to encourage comfort and freedom and like a no mistakes atmosphere, but then you also decided to go the route of, you know, not over rehearsing and just putting music. Because if I were to take the same goal of trying to make people as comfortable as possible, I would do the opposite. You know, I would go just like really make sure they had all the material as ahead of time as possible, make sure we've played it in many different contexts so it becomes a platform to play on. Regardless, I guess it's clear both approaches work.
Yeah, I think one of the things what it is when you have played so many years with individuals, you build this trust among one another. So you tend to worry less about what's going to happen because you kind of know how each individual approaches how they play. You know, and with Chris, we did a lot of work trio. You know, we did a couple tours, trio tours with his trio where I think in Europe, we were in Europe for a few weeks, and that was trio with Larry Grenadier.
Yeah.
And then we did a tour of the States, and that was with Scott Colley. So, you know, we've kind of built a rapport over the years, and the same with Linda. Linda and I played a lot with Jalil's band, and we played in, you know, with Donnie McCaslin and other people. So, you know, it's a level of comfortability when you have these, your peers that you've played with quite a bit. So, you know, I kind of almost equate it to like when, you know, even though I never got to see the band live, but, you know, Duke Ellington knowing band member so well, like he knew how to write, especially for Johnny Hodges or Harry Carney. Like he knew how these guys played. So I feel like kind of the same thing with, you know, with Chris and Linda. I've played with them so much that I wasn't worried. You know what I mean? And you know, another thing was like, it wasn't like, I don't think it was like too many. There was one tune that might have been a little tricky, but the rest of the stuff was just like kind of like really feel good stuff that we could kind of just rip through and not have to rehearse. Because I don't know, sometimes I feel like when you rehearse so much, it kind of takes away from the spontaneity of what's going to happen, you know, because it's like, okay, they're so familiar with it that, you know, they're going to, you know, at some point they're going to kind of just go on autopilot of how they approach playing the music. But if you don't give them that option, it's like you're really trusting the individual. I remember one time having to do this record with this recording session with Tom Harrell. And we originally went into the recording session under the understanding that we were going to play all standards. And I was like, all right, cool. We'll just play some tunes. We get to the session, and he has a whole batch of new music that he had never seen. But the thing was that he had so much trust and faith in his band members. This was a quintet project that we did. And that quintet had been together for, you know, I guess at that point, maybe for about 7 or 8 years. So he kind of knew, you know, he knew our strengths and our weaknesses. So he knew exactly what to pick. And I think, you know, for me, when I learned a lot from that session today, I was like, man, he really, you know, when you really push or put your trust in somebody, you know, whatever the outcome is, it's really an honest, you know, it's probably like the purest and the most honest outcome that could be. So I learned a lot, and I was like, man, I think prior to that, I was kind of like where I'm like, man, I got to rehearse and got to find a space to rehearse for these cats and kind of make sure the music is perfect. And, you know, I was like, when he did that, I was like, man, like, he's putting so much trust. I got to learn how to trust the individuals that, you know, that I play with even more, because I think there's a reason why you hire certain people, because you know how they play and you know how they're going to sound. So it's like you really have to let go sometimes and just say, look, I know what you're going to bring to the table. I love what you bring to the table. This is why I called you in the first place. So that's kind of my take on it.
So beautiful. Yeah. You, on the subject of trusting what your bandmates and your sidemen, they bring to the table, and the ideas that they bring, do you have memories, if you don't mind sharing, of like what the hang was like between you, Linda, and Chris, or what type of things you were talking about before this record, or maybe even your relationship with Chris and with Linda on more of a less like how they play saxophone or bass, but how they what type of things, ideas do you guys talk about?
You know, we talk about a lot of different things. You know, we talk about the political climate at the time, you know. You know, we talk a lot of different things outside of music, and you know, just about different things that inspires us. You know, I should preface it, when we first got together, I wasn't looking at it as it was my band. Like, I wanted it to be a collective thing. So when we first started playing, before we recorded, this is maybe, I want to say maybe 6 months to a year before we actually recorded, we were going under the moniker of BeBop, the BeBop trio for Blake, O, and Potter.
Wow, nice.
And yeah, so it just kind of worked out that way. But you know, because I you know, we were all, when I talked to them, I was like, man, I want us to all like have input and bring various tunes and just try to play. And so, you know, we did a couple concerts at the gallery, and it was great. You know, we were just, you know, actually the first couple gigs, Linda had, I don't think he, either she had never met Chris, and she definitely hadn't played with him. So I think like the first gig was like their first meeting and first time playing together. And I don't know, it was really just magical. It was like, it was very loose, and, it was, you know, it was just like, we just had a good time, and we weren't really uptight about anything. It was just really like loose, and we were really chill, and we were laughing quite a bit. You know, I was, you know, I'm kind of silly when I get in situations with my friends. I just like having a good time. So, you know, I was probably cracking some jokes and, you know, just laughing about certain things. And, you know, I think with Chris and I, we were talking about our days of, like, playing at the Time Cafe, club we used to play underneath with Dominguez Band. There was a club underneath the Time Cafe called The Fez, and that's where the Dominguez Band played for, you know, 10 plus years. So we were just talking about our times there, and just like, because I think when I first joined the band, I was like 18, and I think Chris was like, yeah, maybe just turned 21 or 22, so he was just having his birthday at the Time Cafe where he was able to drink and stuff. So we were just reminiscing over those times and just like, you know, that was, you know, it was a beautiful time, but it was also like tricky, you know, like it was, you know, you were dealing with guys that were 20 plus years older than you. And so they, you know, some of them were like, had attitudes like, who are these young cats coming in here? You know? So it was like, you know, it's kind of like baptism by fire, man. Like we had to really be on our P's and Q's and just really try to make the music sound great. So it was just, you know, it was like, we used to say like, man, if we can make it through that band, we can make it through anything. Cause it was tough. You know, you're dealing with 15 or 16 other people's, you know, different attitudes about life or whatever. So it's like, you know, so it could be a challenge, but you know, so we would reminisce about that with some of the things we talk about. You know, Chris, well, and Linda too, we were talking about like just different writing skills, different writing styles, and where they, you know, where they gain their influences from. I think I had just come back from a trip from Europe, and I think one of the stops was in Paris. So I was talking about one of the museums I love to go to when I'm there, called the L'Orange, and they have, you know, have different, you know, these great displays of Monet and these different artists. So, so I think I might have been talking about that. I mean, and how, you know, how that has kind of influenced, you know, some of my writing too. So,
I thought that kind of segued into a question I wanted to ask you.
All right.
Beforehand, yeah, about how, some things that influence your composing. So, so it sounded like going to that museum, L'Orange, that influenced the way your process for composing, and if you were inspired by certain things. So, maybe you could tell us some things that have inspired you to compose, and also what messages you hope people take from your compositions.
Okay. Definitely I'm influenced by different art that I've come across. You know, I love visiting museums, you know, especially in Paris. Like, there's so many amazing museums. I remember one year there was a, I'm trying to remember what museum that was, but there was this whole Miles Davis exhibit. And, you know, it was like, you know, you were going through, it was like, you know, so many different levels you know, from his time, from his early start. They had the horn that he used for the Gil Evans, Miles Davis projects. They had Tony Williams drums. They had, handwritten manuscript of Footprints the first time he brought, you know, Wayne brought it in to the Miles Davis. So, you know, it was just great to see that. And it happened to be that particular thing was on display at this museum in Paris when I was there, so it was great to have an opportunity to go there. But, you know, I've also gone to the Louvre and, you know, seen the pictures of like the Mona Lisa and stuff like that. So I think I feel like all of those things kind of, you know, in one way or another, kind of shape how I compose, or I think about those things when I come back or sit at the piano or sit at the drums. But also I'm inspired by, you know, my family. I have two kids. So I'm inspired by watching them grow. I think on the CD, on Trion CD, there's a tune called No Bebop Daddy. And that's a tune that I wrote after the story that I heard Donnie McCaslin talk about with his son. And the story was that, you know, I prefaced it by saying, like, yeah, this is dedicated to Donnie McCaslin's son, Henry, who, when I wrote the song, he was about three or something. And the story was that Donnie was driving his kids into school. He lives in Brooklyn. He was driving into Manhattan to drop his kids off at school. And he always loved listening to Bird in Flight on KCR every morning. And so he had his kids strapped up in the back. And I think at one point he's listening to it and he said, Bird is like killing on like Cherokee or something like this. And then from the back, he kind of hears this loud yelling like, no, no, Daddy, no Bebop. And he's like, what the heck does this dude know about Bebop? And then he's like, I want to hear the Beatles, Sgt. Pepper's. And so, oh, all right. so he's like, well, yeah, this was weird. So he thought it was like a fluke. So, I guess maybe like a week or so later, same type of thing. It's early morning. He got the kids in the car. He's driving them to school. And Bird, he cuts on Bird in Flight. And, you know, again, Bird is ripping through something, you know, now's the time or whatever. And then, you know, he gets in. He's like in the middle of something. All of a sudden, it's like, no. And it was almost like the second time he said it was like almost like, man, didn't you hear me last week when I told you like, no? Like, and it was like, no. No Bebop, Daddy. I want to hear Sgt. Pepper's, the Beatles. So it was just like, so, you know, I was on tour, of, you know, with Donnie when this story came, and I just fell out, and it just inspired that tune, No Bebop, Daddy, when I wrote it. I was like, I don't know, for some reason that came into my head, because I just loved that story. I thought it was hilarious that this little kid at like 2 or 3 years old is like, no Bebop.
At so, least he has, you know, good taste.
Yeah, no, you can't go wrong with the Beatles.
No, so, not at all.
So, yeah, I gained inspiration from different things, you know, like, you know, taking walks. That's for me, honestly, I think that's what had been so hard early on in this lockdown, because I wasn't able to get out, you know, like I wasn't able to get out and interact, you know, it was like we were very limited on what we could do. So it was like, man, I felt like I couldn't gain any inspiration for a while. And then when stuff started slowly opening up, I was like, oh, man, now I can kind of slowly get back to certain things I was going for walks in the park, or, you know, just, you know, maybe being able to interact with, you know, friends of mine again. So, yeah, I mean, I think for me, I just try to take my inspiration from my different surroundings that I find myself in, different places that I've been, different countries that I've traveled to where, you know, I love the architect or whatever. Just, you know, I remember one time, there was a tune that I wrote some time ago for when I first went to the Canary Islands. It was just like, almost like paradise on earth or something like that. And I wrote a tune for that. And, you know, and then also, you know, there's, I think on, also on that record, there's a tune of mine called West Berkeley Street. And that's for the street I grew up on when I, you know, in Philadelphia. And it kind of, you know, it's kind of, when I came up with that melody, I was kind of, it kind of reminded me of like, stuff I would hear on the radio, or stuff like in the summertime, it's like hanging out in, you know, in the back of my house and hearing, you know, neighbors blasting the radio of like stuff from the 70s and the 80s. So, you know, when I wrote that melody, I was like, man, that kind of reminds me of back home. And so, you know, for a while I was like, I didn't have a title. And then I think I was playing in Philly and we played the song. And I think I announced, I was like, I think I'm going to call this song West Berkeley Street, because that's the street I grew up on, and then kind of reminisce of those times. So, yeah, it just, you know, it just depends. You know, I think, you know, all these, you know, all these encounters that I've had have really helped shape me. And I think one of the main things that I want people to get from my music is that it's, you know, it's honest and it's memorable. Like, I like creating memorable melodies that kind of stick in your head, you know. I don't like writing hard melodies just for the sake of it being hard. I want people to be able to walk away either humming or whistling the songs that I write. And, you know, becoming kind of like an earworm in a way. You know, I don't know. I just like that. I like, because I feel like when you write something that's very melodic, it's easier to latch onto. It's easier to you know, to grab.
Yeah, there was one song. Did something just happen with the audio?
Yeah.
Was it with me? Did you hear a piano?
Yeah, it must have. Yeah, I heard a piano.
Yeah. My roommate, I think she's practicing.
Oh, okay.
A little bit of thin walls.
There was one song on the record, Trion, that I wanted to talk about, Good Hope. So you mentioned like maybe like 10 minutes ago about just like how you want to have like good vibes. That's what I'm paraphrasing, but I felt so much of that, and that relates to just having good, like really like singable melodies on.
Yeah.
And like just great to listen to, and I feel like I used to be a little daunted, honestly, by like trios, just because there's no chords and it's sometimes hard to figure out what's going on, and your compositions were just so, they were inviting for people, and especially that one too. And there's one part where Linda, she starts playing like a 1 4 2 5 1.
Oh, right.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know that. I know exactly what that part is, right?
Yeah. So it's a very. I was playing at a theme park last summer. Actually, this theme park, and we did this.
Oh, okay.
We did this carnival, and it was in Virginia. We did this carnival, and one of the songs in the carnival dance, like we were all like just like dancing and like trying to like dance with people in the crowd and stuff. And one of the songs would have that like 1 4 2 5, and then it made me think of that right away.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, I mean, like, no, I love those. I love that energy, because I feel like, you know, music in general is supposed to uplift and upbuild and you know, make people forget about their daily routine, whatever they went through at work or whatever they went through in this particular day. You know, there's, you know, if there's that one moment that they can just escape that, I feel like we've done our job. So I like that. I like, you know, I like being able to, you know, take people on a journey and make them forget about their daily life. You know, I recently played a gig with at Smoke, I guess it was about 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago with my group. And that was one of the things that I was reading in the comments after the show. It was like, man, you know, you guys transported us and we needed this during this time, you know. And it was like, man, if I can do that, then I feel like I've done my job as a musician. Because when you think about, you know, musicians back in the day, that's what they were trying to do. They were trying to upbuild, you know. This was a dance music. It was, you know, it was supposed to make people feel good. But it was also, you know, it was also supposed to bring awareness and attention to also things that weren't so good during that time, you know. And I feel that's important too, to, excuse me, to really have messages in your music too. You know, I try to bring that out too. It's like, it is about having a good time, but it's also about bringing awareness to people who might not know about what's going on or who might choose to turn a blind eye to it. And I think, you know, in general, I think, you know, over the years, people have always looked to artists to see what was going to be the next, you know, the next thing, or like where are we going to go from here. They always look to artists to like define what was going to be next. And so I feel like that's, you know, I feel that torch has to be carried on, and we have to continue to do that also.
So when you say artists need to lead the way, do you mean that artists should be educating people as to current events, in addition to providing these good feelings for people and letting them escape from their realities?
I think it's important to, yeah, I think it is important for artists to do that. I think it's important for us to have, you know, like I said, we have, you know, our good times and our good vibes, but I also think it's important for us to have messages in our music too, that, you know, especially if there's, you know, if there's something that's not right. I mean, you know, there's been tunes that I've written, about, you know, about certain things that I, you know, that I've seen on video or in the news. And I think it's, you know, for me, I think it's just important. I, you know, and I also think that, you know, the artists that came before me were doing the same thing, you know, Max Roach, Abby Lincoln, John Coltrane, you know, they all, there's a song Alabama by John Coltrane, which was, you know, in dedication to the four little girls who, you know, who died in the 16th Street Baptist Church bombing. So I think, you know, I think it's so important to not only look at one aspect of the music, but also to bring awareness to people who might not feel comfortable talking about it or whatever. You know, like it's not an easy conversation to have, but I think if you're honest about it, I feel like it can be done. But if you don't, I feel like if you don't do that, you know, one of the things that my parents used to stress to myself and I have two younger sisters, was like, man, if you don't speak up when something's going wrong, then you're just as bad as the person who's committing the act of violence or whatever. You know, you're part of the problem. You're not helping the situation. So that always kind of stuck with me. Like, I'm like, okay, I can't just sit back and watch this and not say anything, because then I'm just as bad as the person who's doing the act or whatever. So, you know, whenever I saw something going on that I thought was wrong, I was like, you know, either I would speak on it or I would bring awareness to it through my music, as other artists did before me. You know, even in, you know, folk and R&B and rock music, there were some, you know, you think about some of the music that John Denver wrote, some of the music that all these cats were writing during that time, like during the 60s and 70s. It was like, you know, it was a message behind some of the stuff they were doing. But there was also, you know, that same message about, you know, feeling good and loving one another and making people aware that we all want the same thing. We all want, you know, to be treated equally and be treated right, and we all want our freedom. So, you know, I just really feel that it's important for us to do that. And I don't know, in a way I feel it's been, how should I say it? I think in a way sometimes it's easy for us to just hide behind our computers and post stuff about it, but to really get out there in the public and in the public eye and really speak on it, to me, is also very important. So I've just been trying to be more of an advocate for that, and just really, you know, when I have the platform to speak, just really not shying away from any of it. So
maybe you could talk about some records that you listened to growing up, or even recently, that you think really impacted you as to a message that they were trying to convey, whether it be politically or just in the world, something that they want to change. Is there any records that you can think of that just really did a great job, that like really is ingrained in you, a message that they were trying to spread?
You know, well, you know, one that really comes to mind is like Freedom Suite. You know, to me that is like, you know, it was just, you know, just that playing on there, but just, you know, like to me, like that, well, I would say number one, the playing was just like, you could hear like what they were trying to convey without even, you know, really saying anything, you know what I mean? Like you could hear it in the playing. And I, you know, I always try to go back to that and you know, and then also like some of Ornette's music, like, you know, This Is Our Music from the record from This Is Our Music. Just, I don't know. I feel like there's just really, there's this sense of urgency when you hear these types of records and put them on. And, I don't think it's necessarily always about trying to be angry about the situation. It's about, really the urgency of bringing awareness to the situation. So, and then, you know, like, I also go back, even though it's more, it's not, maybe not thought of as a protest music, but, you know, I always go back to, you know, like Love Supreme and how John and Elvin and McCoy approached that record and Jimmy, you know, you could hear that they were really, you know, calling out, you know, and you know, in a way, like John, I feel like what John had brought on that record was just, it was different from anything else that he had recorded since, you know, prior to that. So, you know, for me, I think those are some of the records that I kind of go back to gain, I guess, gain the confidence to be able to speak out. Because it's not my, I'm not naturally the most outgoing person. I can be kind of introverted, and, you know, unless I'm around, like, friends that I'm comfortable with. So, for me, sometimes hearing those records and listening to them or hearing them speak in interviews or wherever, it kind of it helps me to gain the confidence to say, okay, it's okay to speak on this or whatever, or it's okay to write about this situation, or it's okay for me to even have these feelings that I'm having and speak about it that way. So, yeah, I mean, I think that's, for me, I mean, there's a lot more. I mean, there's, you know, some of the stuff that Sly and the Family Stone were talking about on, like, Stand and, you know, some of the early Public Enemy records, like, you know, Fight the Power, and, you know, like, it was just...
Marvin Gaye.
You know, some of that's, yeah, Marvin Gaye, what's going on? Like, all that stuff really, you know, comes back. And for me, it's really important. You know, I feel like, man, if these people were doing that back then, like, it's really important for me to do it now. You know, so I feel like if I don't do it, then I'm doing a disservice from all these people that came before me and did it.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking about, you know, we have this one kind of entertainment function, which is to uplift and bring people out of their day-to-day, let's call it routines. I was going to say miseries, but I don't want to be that dark. Just call it routines, right? So bring them out of their day and give them something enjoyable, danceable, maybe. But then we also have this need to be the force that moves society forward, you know? Mm-hmm. Be the front line of that. And I'm trying to reconcile these two in my mind, because it's a big controversy. I think people think of sports in the same way. They say, this is my time to get away from the news and things. But mm-hmm. now I see, and they have all this Black Lives Matter on the sports. Like, what are they doing here? Mm-hmm. And people come, I think a lot of people who come to a club looking for dance music, and they hear this suite composed for political reasons or those type of messages, they have this conflict of interest. So I'm thinking, if we take a broader definition of quality art, let's say, it is to convey emotions that words can't accurately really convey feelings, emotions that words can't really portray. Even with dance music, it's not just enough to say happiness or joy exuberance or something. Like, there is a feeling that just can't be described that those things give you. And then when I'm thinking about Alabama, you know, it's not immediately evident that he's talking about the 16th Street bombing, but you hear it, and you hear this indescribable pain, this outcry, this outreach, and you're motivated to seek and understand why he's in that and discover. Right. And I'm thinking about this in terms of all the records you spoke about, Alabama and Sly and the Family Stone and all these different types of things. But it also makes me think about the role of lyrics in protest music, because when I first introduced the idea of protest music to a lot of non-musician people, they're like, well, this song doesn't make me think of this bombing or this atrocity or this tragedy. Mm. What don't you need lyrics to tell somebody what that is? And you posted a video of Fables of Phobos, which I think is also interesting. So we have Coltrane, Alabama, Fables of Phobos, and all sorts of examples of protest music that have no lyrics. How do you go about composing or playing in a way that conveys those messages without being so explicit?
Well, that's a great question. I mean, I think you kind of hit it, man. It's you know, like you said, like when you hear Train play Alabama, you don't necessarily maybe know right away that he's talking about what he's talking about, but there's an emotion that he conveys with how he plays the melody, how he takes his time with, you know, how he builds the melody, and then when it breaks out into like the swing and he just starts playing these long bending notes, you kind of start to envision it or you start to feel it. And I think with music that has no lyrics, there's ways to convey that with how you approach playing the song. Like you know, there's certain things. There's a tune that I have that I wrote. It's part of the suite that I wrote called My Laugh Matters. And it's called Last Breath. And it's in tribute to Eric Garner, who died at the hands of the cops, you know, when they put him in a chokehold. And, you know, you might not know right away what the message is, but I think once you start to really take your time. I feel like one of the things that we've gotten away from is really learning how to listen to music, you know, because we have so much information being, you know, pumped at us at the push of a button that, you know, we really have gotten away from how to really just sit down and listen to music. I always talk to my students about like how, man, when I was coming up, you know, I never had like iTunes and stuff like that. So I was like, you know, if I wanted something, I needed to go to the library. I needed to check out the album and, you know, and have it for a week and then bring it back. But, you know, having those albums, like I would literally listen from the start of the record all the way to the one side, flip it over and listen to, you know, like we don't do that anymore. We skip through tracks. So it really, I think we really have to get back to learning how to really listen to music, number one. Mm-hmm. And I think once we do that, you can hear these little nuances that really can trigger a certain emotion about what it is or the message that the, you know, the composer is trying to convey. You know, in little things, like even with my tune Last Breath, you know, towards the end of it, it really like explodes into this really big thing, because you're like, you know, for me it was like I'm seeing this video of this man taking his last breath, like, you know, and people are screaming in the background, and then it kind of like dies down, and it start, you know, and the song kind of starts to get a little slower, and for me it was like it was representing, you know, Eric's very last breath that he took before, you know, he died. So, you know, all these little things, like if you really take the time to listen to it, you'll start to feel it. You'll start to it'll really start to evoke a certain emotion to you, you know, even if you don't have lyrics. I feel that there's been plenty of times where I've heard a song, you know, like when I would go out and hear somebody's song live, and I wouldn't even know the name of the tune until the end of the song, but it would evoke a certain emotion in me. And then when I would hear the name of the song finally, I was like, dang, that makes so much sense. Like, it just, that really resonated with me. And it was like, you know, it would be an instrumental group. It wouldn't be a group with vocals. So, and I think it also depends on the artist. If the artist is really in tune with how to approach, playing a melody, or how to approach, you know, how to sing a melody, how to, you know, how to convey that. I think people pick up on it. I think also if it's honest, I think people, it affects people differently. you know? So it's just, I think in a way it's for us, it's, you know, really, you know, I was talking today with a friend of mine. I was doing an interview today, and, you know, telling her, you know, we were both sharing how it's also been kind of weird not being able to play in front of people or for people. But we were also saying it's kind of nice to actually sometimes sit or lay in your bed and just let the music kind of take over you. And I was telling her, you know, I was watching, who was I watching? I think I was watching a solo drum thing of Marcus Gilmore from the Vanguard. And I just remember kind of laying on my bed and just kind of zoning out. And and it was just like something kind of took over my body, just like how he was, you know, how he's approaching playing. And I said, man, I really enjoyed that. Because sometimes I feel like when you're at a concert, you can't really do that as much, because it might look weird, or it might look as you're being disrespectful, like you're not paying attention to the music.
You might look asleep.
Right, exactly. You know, people could mistake that, like, oh, this dude, we bored him, we put him to sleep or something. Mm. But when you're in the confines of your own personal space, I feel like you're able to really ingest music a little differently, and I kind of feel like I've been able to do that, even though we haven't had the luxury of playing in front of people for about a year now. So it also has gotten me back into listening differently, you know. And I think when we do that, then the emotion automatically comes, you know. Mm.
Yeah, I mean, I'll be quick, Mike.
No worries.
You just ticked off this awesome light bulb for me, because Mike and I, we do live streamed concerts similar to like what you saw with the Vanguard. Mm-hmm. And what we keep hearing from musicians and people is that, like, yeah, I mean, it's never the same as live and things. but in a way, what you're saying is that live can sometimes be a distraction. Obviously, I've had incredible experiences seeing music live, but then also the other hand, sometimes it, like, there's a girl sitting next to that you're like distracted by. There's drinks clinking and like people you want to talk to in the room, and like, you know, there is, when I think of some of the most impactful moments where music has had an effect on me, a lot of it has been headphones on in bed. Or alone on a bench, walking, or you know, sitting, and so I'm feeling like this could be the value of our live streams going
into the future. Yeah.
So thank you so much for that.
Yeah. No problem. No, I think, you know, we have to make the best out of these situations, and I feel like this is one of the ways. I kind of remember like when I would play at the Vanguard with Tom Harrell, people were listening with their eyes, like they're watching, oh, well, he's shaking when he plays or whatever. And I'm like, you're not listening with your ears. You're paying more attention to what, you know, what it looks like to you on the stage. And you're not really tuning into the beauty that's happening, you know, on the stage, you know. So, certain people can be easily distracted. But I feel like, you know, this situation that we find ourselves in has really... it's just great that we are able to still play, but I think it's also been really beneficial for people to really feel no judgment about, you know, about how they listen to music or, you know, or being in a situation. So, for me, it's not seeing the person live, but I like being able to kind of chill out with, you know, a glass of wine or whatever and just... And let the music pour all over me, take over me, and take me to different places. Being able to go on a journey with the musician that I'm listening to, or, you know, or just go on my own journey and just really just tune out, you know, just really go into a different place and a different mind space. I've been really enjoying that. So I think that's one way how we can. How we can really feel what what the person or what the composer's intention was when he wrote, when he or she wrote a certain song. So really just really getting back to focusing and listening and just and letting the, you know, letting the story kind of be dictated to you without words.
I wanted to just jump on what you were saying earlier about how when you were coming up, you had to go to the library and pick up a record, and then you would listen to that for a week and then return it. Mm-hmm. I've heard other people talk about that too. Someone I can think of, Kenny Washington, right off the bat, he would talk about the importance of that too, you know, and I honestly have. Personally, a hard time definitely sticking to one thing a lot with music, and I think it has to do with just with how much is available at our fingertips, and it's so easy to just click on different things. So, right. do you find that your listening experience has changed as the technology has changed, or do you still mainly do like a similar approach that you've done in the past?
Well, it's definitely changed a little bit, but I still try to go back to that time. You know, I have a record player here. You know, I can remember, you know, when I was coming up in Philly, my father had like a studio built in our basement, you know, kind of a soundproof studio. And that's where he had his stereo and he had an Avid record collection. That's also where I was regulated to when I started taking drum lessons. Like, I, you know, parents didn't want me making all that noise in the living room and dining room, so I was regulated to the basement. But I can remember, many a days and nights just going down there and getting lost in a record that I, you know, that I had no idea. I was just curious because I was into music. So I would just put on the headphones, put on the record, and just literally zone out, man. You know, just being transported. And I just, you know, for me it was just an education. You know, it was an enjoyment. I just really loved the music, but you know, I was also being educated that way about how to really, even though I wasn't thinking about it at that point, but it was really teaching me how to learn to listen to music. So I, you know, like, I guess it depends on, now it kind of depends on what, you know, what I'm doing. Like, if I'm learning music, you know, if I'm learning music for a gig or for recording, I'll engulf myself in that music because, you know, I want to be able to not have to rely on reading the music. You know, like, I like to be able to get away from the music and really try to make it my own. Sometimes if I'm relying too much, too heavily on looking at the paper, it kind of hinders my creativity, I think. But if I can internalize that music, then I feel like I have the more freedom to express how I want to approach playing the song or playing the music that I've been asked to learn. So, I'll still do that. Now, if it's something where, you know, I don't have a lot of time and I'm just, and I have to, you know, learn something or just play something really quickly, I might skip around to like the songs I want to pay attention to a little more. But for the most part, man, like when I buy records, even if it's a record I buy on iTunes or whatever, I still sit and zone out, dude. Like, I'll put on my noise cancellation headphones and just listen to the whole record, you know? Because I feel like, in a way, when people are creating music and creating albums, they're telling their version of a story, you know? And so I want to hear, oh, why did this person put the order like this, or what was his thing? What was he or she's thinking behind the order that they put on this record? You know, so I, you know, the only way to do that is to really just engross yourself in the recording. I don't like to just sit down and say, okay, hear like 15 seconds of it and be like, oh, I don't really like that. Let me skip to the next one. Oh, this is cool. Maybe I'll sit with it. No, I'd listen to the whole thing, and just. and listen to it a few times sometimes. And then maybe later on, like, okay, I really dig this song. Let me hear this again. But, you know, when I first buy records or, you know, or CDs, like, yeah, I listen to the whole thing. And I don't know. It's just something that I've grew up listening, you know, doing from the time I was very young when I started taking drum lessons at the age of 10. So, and all my teachers encouraged me to listen as much as I could. So that kind of just stuck with me, and I still do it today. And it's, I mean, now, like we were talking earlier, it's so easy to skip around because it's just, you know, it's just, you know, it's not, you know, it's not analog, it's not vinyl, it's like digital, so you can just skip on your computer. But I really feel like you miss so much when you do that. So I've just been trying to be, I always try to just be mindful of, like, okay, I spent my $9.99 on this CD. I want to listen to it. You know, I want to see, I want to see what the thinking was behind this person. So, you know, I think one of the last CDs I bought, or that I downloaded was, I think Gerald Clayton's last record, Live from the Vanguard, and I bought it one night, and I stayed up and listened to it the whole night, you know, because I was just like, I want to zone out. I want to hear what his thinking was behind the way he, you know, put the songs in order. And I, you know, for me, I felt like I think I came to one of the nights of that particular gig. I don't think it was the night they were taping, but I just wanted to, you know, I wanted to feel like I was in the room, so to speak. So I kind of just put my noise cancellation headphones here in my practice room and just zoned out, man. And, you know, I feel like I felt like I get a little better idea of the person's concept, his conception, and, you know, kind of get in that person's head a little more. So, yeah.
Can I pop in with a, sorry, my roommate's still practicing, so you might hear a little bit. But we actually got a question on Instagram from a friend of ours, Joe Giordano, and he asked, how do we get our protest music to reach more people? Which, when I read that, I was thinking of it from, like, a reach and, like, marketing almost. Like, how do we get this out to more ears, right? But it struck me that, you know, really the purpose, I think, of this question is how do we get our protest music to impact more people? And so everything we're talking about with encouraging people to listen deeply, encouraging you know, listening to albums all the way through and, like, not skipping around, and then earlier what we were talking about with playing with emotion and being cathartic, and it's all embedded in how do we get this music to impact more people. But I wanted to get your take on how do we get our protest music to reach or impact more people.
Well, I think you hit it, man. I think, you know, I think, well, that's one of the things that has been great about social media in a way. Like, you know, we're able to present and share our music pretty quickly, you know, whether it be on Facebook, whether it be on Instagram, whether it be on these various platforms. But I also think, like what you said, is When music is honest and it's played honestly, people feel it right away, you know. When you're not sure about yourself, or when you're a little apprehensive about should I play this song, it's going to sound that way, and people are not going to respond. But if you're really honest and you put all that emotion in what you're doing and that conviction in what you're playing, people feel it right away, you know, without you even having to say something. I mean, I can't tell you how many times that I've stepped off stage and I see people with tears in their eyes, man. They don't even have to say anything to you. You just know right away. Like, I remember one time I was playing in, where was I playing? This is recent. This was like February of last year, one of the last tours I did before the lockdown. I was in Europe with a friend of mine. And we're playing this club, one of my favorite clubs in Neuenberg, Germany, called Birdland. And Yeah, it's called Birdland. And we come out, we play, and you know, the music that we're playing is very, it's very emotional, it's very very moody, it's very, you know, it's very it hits you, you know. And I remember looking out, and this lady, she's like bawling, like she's in tears, you know, like. And she didn't even have to say anything to us, like, after the show. I mean, she did make it a point to come on. She's like, oh, my God, you guys just took me somewhere else and really, you know, and really evoked this emotion. I know you guys saw me crying. And she was, like, trying to apologize. I was like, you don't need to apologize for that. Like, if this is what you felt, then we did our job. You know, we created that emotion. So we did our job. So I think it's the same thing. It's like, if it's played with conviction, if it's played honestly, you know, that's how you get it out there. People will hear it and react to it. It'll resonate with them because you put it out there, and it was like you weren't trying to hide. You weren't apprehensive about putting it out there. So I think that's what we have to do. We have to be more mindful of how we convey our message. We have to be more mindful of not being afraid to take that leap of faith, so to speak, and say, look, this might rub people. Even if it does, that's cool too. Even if it makes somebody feel uncomfortable, that's cool too. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it might make somebody angry. It might, you know, whatever. I mean, those emotions that these people feel, it's, to me, it's you know, it's okay. It's okay to have anger. It's okay to feel sadness. It's okay to feel happiness. That's, you know, to me, that's what it's about. You know, it's, look, we're having this dialogue, so to speak. We're having this conversation, and if this evokes a certain emotion out of you, that's cool. At least you're hearing it and you're feeling where we're coming from. And what's that?
I didn't say anything.
I just said, yeah, I was just I was thinking of it as like a dialogue starter. You know, even if they disagree with you, you said they need to hear where we're coming from.
Right, right. Yeah. I mean, it's so easy to play music for people that agree with everything you say, or you know, even have a dialogue or a conversation with people that, you know, agree with everything you say. But it's even, for me, it's even more important to have these conversations with people that don't see it the same way you do, or feel the way you do about these certain situations. And, you know, a lot of times if you convey it in a certain way and they're open and you kind of approach it without, like, you know, saying, well, you're wrong, or this, or, you know, or kind of, you know, that kind of attitude. I've had experiences where people are a lot more open, you know, and I think that's, I think that's important to be able to reach those that don't, you know, to kind of reach across the floor and reach those that don't really see it the way you see it, you know. So
I think this is such a important point, because I think in the jazz community, we tend to be, like, super, pretty left-wing, especially in New York City, just by demographics and things.
Right.
And it can be easy to feel like we're in an echo chamber, you know, because, you know, we're playing to each other, people who largely agree. And I love your open-mindedness of, like, you know, let's confront other people with understanding and have a dialogue about things. Can you elaborate more on some of these experiences that you have? Have you ever played this suite for anybody and then had a more honest conversation because of it, or have seen something similar to that happen?
Oh, yeah. You know, so the suite, the title of the suite is called My Life Matters. And it's, you know, basically it's dealing with what we were talking about, you know, saying, look, not being afraid to speak out and speak up against things that we see are not wrong, because if we don't do that, then, you know, we're part of a problem, like I was saying earlier. So, and, you know, My Life Matters is also dealing with, like, you know, I want you to think of me, but I also am thinking of you. Like, I don't want you to think that your voice doesn't matter. We all matter. And if we if we see that, if we see that when we cut ourselves, we all bleed the same, then I think it's going to be, then this world will be a much easier place to live in. So when I first premiered it, it was actually live at the Jazz Gallery. And, I had people coming up to me afterwards, man. I was like, dude, this is a very important work. I they wanted to really know if I was going to ever record it, which I haven't had the opportunity to do yet, but I'm looking to record it at the, towards the end of this year and, hopefully put it out next year. And then I would play parts of it on gigs that I had. I remember, a friend of mine had this series by like Princeton area in Princeton, New Jersey. He has this beautiful barn that he converted into a performance space. And I played a gig there with my, I think it was quartet or quintet. And Dana was on the gig, I remember. And Dana's actually one of the members in this particular band. So we played the last two or three movements of it. And I remember, we were playing this concert and it was for a predominantly white audience. But I remember them like right after, like, yo, we want to support you and whatever you're doing, like to try to get this music out. Like they really, again, it goes back to how we conveyed, how we played. It was very honest. We didn't shy away from what we were going to play. I think one of the movements, I'm trying to think, what's the name of that? I might have to look at the name of the tune. I can't remember the name of the tune. One is called We'll Never Know. One is called Can Tomorrow Be Brighter? And another movement is called We'll Never Know, you never got to try, meaning like you you were taken away from us too early, so we never knew what you could have been. Mm-hmm. And so I remember like the guy, the owner of this performance space, he even said, he was like, man, this is such an important work. And he was like, I really want to try to get this in major venues. And he said, the other thing is like, this is an uncomfortable conversation that needs to be had. That was one of the things that he said to the audience. And he said, it's an important conversation to have. And it's also an uncomfortable conversation to have. But if we continue to turn a blind eye to this, then we're no better than these people that have committed these crimes. So I thought that was really, a poignant point that he made to say, because him being a white person and, speaking to, a group of other white people, it was really amazing that, somebody would stand up for, for us. And I thought that was beautiful. So I think it has to be these situations where we, bring the music to people who might not be comfortable hearing it. That's what I'm saying. Like, reaching across the aisle and say, look, we can't continue to just shy away from the subject. It needs to be heard. You need to listen and respond. For me, I think it's, I think that, when you have people like, who are willing to stand up and stand and fight with you, I think it just makes it that much easier. We're stronger in numbers. And so, if we don't have that support, then it's just, it's just like a vicious cycle that continues to happen.
One moment. Sorry. I'm turning my mic gain up and down so you don't hear it practicing.
Yeah, it's all good. It's all good.
But on that same subject, he was very honest in saying that, it was an uncomfortable discussion for the venue of his audience. And, I think I briefly spoke to you when we scheduled this call, on this podcast, we haven't talked about protest music. We haven't talked about these type of current events for that very same reason. We're like, mm-hmm. you know, we're a music podcast. Do we really want to alienate parts of our audience or things like that? But then the more I thought about it, the more I was just like, you know, if this is on artists' minds and on the conscience of our country, then we can't shy away from the discussion, even if they're are opposing opinions or anything like that. Is we have to have open dialogue and mutual respect for one another. So that's awesome story you shared about
I think you hit it, man. Like, I think if we come to it with a respect for one another, I think it makes it that much easier for people to feel free to discuss their views, even if it's something that we don't necessarily see eye to eye on. But if you approach it every single time with like, no, you're wrong, or man, this is unacceptable, you know, you're right, you know, it automatically creates this emotion of anger or causing people to shut down, depending on, you know, the person's personality. So I try to take the approach of like, okay, yeah, I'm going to play this music and yeah, I'm going to talk about it, but I'm also going to be open to hear your opinion. I'm also going to make it so that it's melodic, so that you walk away singing it too. Because, you know, if you heard the tune, you could walk away singing and it sticks with you, and maybe that will also trigger something like, oh man, I love this tune, but also I love the message. Let me think about what I could do. So a lot of times, like when, I don't know, at least for me, like if music, when I hear music that kind of forsakes the melody, it doesn't necessarily leave a lasting impression on me. But when I hear music that is more melodic based and it's a melody that I can walk away singing, it sticks with me a lot longer. So a lot of these tunes, even though they're about, you know, these injustices that we come across, I try to also make it a point that it's very melodic so that people can latch onto it and kind of walk away and keep it in their minds and say, oh man, like I love this tune. And then they automatically, if they remember the tune, they'll remember what was presented to them at that particular show, and that might invoke them to want to get involved even more, or want to have that open dialogue that we speak about. So
I feel like there's a certain intensity that needs to be had in the music to spread on a message of being more aware of a certain subject. And like you said, I don't know if this is true scientifically, but I'm pretty sure that music can retain itself better if there's a melody tied to a word or just in general than just regular speech. So the idea of encapsulating an idea that you want people to have inside a beautiful piece of music is, I think, one of the best ways to just spread a message to people, you know? Mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask you, So from my opinion, like listening to Alabama, for instance, by John Coltrane, there's such a strong intensity in the way that he plays. And like you said, if you are exposed to some music long enough, then you will be able to hear, like, maybe you won't get the title exactly, but you can understand the emotions that the artists are trying to put upon you. Mm-hmm. So what's your mindset approach before playing for people, especially if you have a specific idea in mind that you want to give to people? Like before you start playing the suite, My Life Matters, what mindset, is there like a mindset routine you try to get yourself into before approaching that piece?
I think one of the things that I try to at least for myself, is really try to focus on pacing and breathing, you know, like really trying to take my time and really try to create this whole story, this whole narrative that I want to try to convey. I think for us as artists, it's so easy for us to go on autopilot and just say, okay, like, we're going to just go out here and just play it like that, you know, but like, yeah. It's another thing to really take your time and really try to pace yourself and say, look, we're going to do it this way. And, you know, a lot of that can be finding the right tempo, not just starting right away, you know, or really taking your time to get the right, you know, the right tempo for each tune. And, you know, and that really takes, it takes concentration. So I, you know, a lot of times before I start breathing, I mean, I start playing, I'm really trying to concentrate. I, you know, I kind of try to find a space, you know, away from people, just like, even if it's like a dark room, and just really try to meditate in a little bit, and then before I get on the stage, and then that way when I do step on stage, there's this level of calmness that comes over me, and then I feel like, okay, now I can convey the message that I'm trying to convey. One of the persons that comes to mind when I either see him play or have the opportunity to play with him is Tom Harrell. Tom, like, after each song or before each song he plays, man, he really takes his time and gets the exact tempo he wants, because he wants to convey this message, because he doesn't really speak that much. He doesn't talk that much. So, and, you know, yeah. Other than announcing the band at the end of the show. So, you know, he still wants to convey his message through his music. So he really, I've seen him do it. I see him do it all the time. Like, before he starts to play, he sits and kind of counts in his head, and before he counts the band off, because he really wants to get that message across. He really wants to pick the right tempo so that, you know, people can latch on to what he's about to play, or what he's about, or the story that he's about to tell, or the journey that he's about to take them on. So I've learned a lot about that from watching him and watching people of that generation. He, Kenny Barron, even slightly older, like people that I've played with, like Pharoah Sanders. And so that's one of the approaches that I try to take. Like, I really try to say, all right, man, I need to focus and just kind of, you know, to take a step back before I start to play. So, you know, I'll do a little bit of breathing and just kind of meditate for a while. And then even if I'm on stage, sometimes I'll take more of a space in between songs, like, if I want to do that, because, you know, I have that opportunity and time to do that. So, like, I don't necessarily feel like I need to be rushed, you know, when I'm on the stage. So, you know, sometimes in between tunes, I'm like, what is this next tune? What's the story I'm trying to convey at this next tune? What's the tempo, you know? Like, how do I want it to feel? How do I want to convey my message to the people that are here? So, yeah, that's one of the things that I continue to do.
You just reminded me, actually. Sorry, I'll just
be
quick. When we were talking to Jaleel Shaw in this podcast a couple of months ago, he gave a story. Austin, do you remember what bassist he was talking about?
What was the story?
He gave a story of how he wrote this song, and I believe it was about someone's death, maybe in his family, and he brought it to the band to rehearse.
It was Linda O, actually.
Oh, it was Linda O? Yeah, I think he brought it to the band, and she didn't know what the context of the story was about behind the song, and she played it one way, I'm sure fantastically, but just not with the same characteristics he wanted. Mm-hmm. So he like brought her aside and just like and talked to her about what it was about, the mm-hmm. song, and then her approach to the song was completely different. Mm-hmm. And I think that story stuck with me because it's so interesting how in one way you think how abstract it can be, like how, but it worked the second time when she knew what the mm-hmm. story was about. It's a really interesting thing because it's at once it's very abstract, because you think like what did she change, you know, but
right,
But with someone having so much finesse on an instrument, you know, any jazz musicians that are really evolved in their craft, they mm-hmm. can somehow transmit a different emotion just on the totally. Note choices and
yeah.
And yeah, it's do you have a specific story at all of like maybe not knowing what something was about, but then realizing and then changing your approach to something?
Yeah. Most recently, there's a tenor player that I play with from Israel. He lives in the city now. His name is Oded Tzura, and we were recording for his debut on ECM. And we had been playing the music for a little while, and we, you know, we all had our vibe on it or whatever. And I remember when we got to the studio, he started telling us stories about what he was thinking about when he wrote these particular pieces. And one of the stories is about, it's called 7 years. And I think at the time when he wrote it, it had been 7 years since the passing of his father.
Oh.
And so, you know, when we, you know, we were sitting and we're listening to the story about, you know, the difficulties that he went through and losing his father, because he lost his father at a very early age. I think he was still in his teens when he lost his dad. So even just by him saying that, I think we all took a different approach. And I think what was funny was like we had maybe done one or two takes of the tune already, and then he told this story. And then we played another take, and that third take was like the take he used, because after that story, it immediately, we went into a whole different vibe. Like it made us start thinking differently and really putting a different energy into the song. Like, you know, I just started envisioning like what it would be like to lose my father or a parent at such an early age. Like, you know, I don't know if he was 18 yet. He might have been 16 or 17 or maybe even younger. So, you know, I just tried to think about as a young man at that age, like what that would, you know, what emotions and what that would have done to me. Like, you know, not having somebody to kind of like, you know, bring me into, you know, help me navigate into adulthood because I, you know, because you passed so early. I mean, I remember when my father died in 2014, I was in my 30s, but it was still, it was still traumatic, you know, like it was just like, man, like, how do I go on? So I can't imagine somebody that young losing a parent. But it also, you know, it also awoken a different approach, at least for me, and I think for the rest of the people, because right after that, I remember he kind of broke down, but it was like, it was beautiful because it was like, he was here. He was like, my dad was here. I felt it. He was here. The energy was here. And it was like, man, we have been playing these tunes for like months, you know, doing tours and, you know, doing gigs in the city. But it was like that one moment right after he told that story, I was like, oh, wow. Now I have a better idea of like how I should approach playing that tune. And I, you know, I think that's important. Like if you have a tune, you know, if you have music that you're playing with people, I think it is sometimes important, like, especially if you want a certain thing out of it. It's like, you know, and if the musician is advanced enough, you know, they'll catch on right away. And I think that's like when you mentioned Linda, like it probably wasn't even something that drastic that Jaleel said to her, but maybe just something little that invoked her to approach it differently. And I've had instances like that in my own band where I'm like, yeah, man, so this song was written because of this, or this is what happened, this is a story. And then, you know, because the musicians that I choose or that whoever, you know, they choose, they know that they can convey what, you know, what you want out of it. So I'm, you know, I remember those changes, but because I think that record, we did that record, when did we do that record? In 2019, I think, June of 2019 or something like that. And I just remember that moment. I was like, oh, wow, man. Like, you know, I've been playing this song all this time, and now I'm like, oh, now I have a different approach to it. Now, you know, now I kind of understand what it meant or what he, you know, what he was trying to convey. So, I think it's, if you can, you know, if you can kind of convey that sometimes, it makes the difference on how you approach playing. You know.
It's interesting he waited that long before.
Yeah, it was deep. Like, yeah, he never really mentioned it. You know, like, he never really. I mean, maybe he just said a little thing like, oh, yeah, yeah, I wrote this, you know, after my dad had been gone for a second. But it, like you had, I guess you just really had to be there, like, to really hear him. To really hear him, how he explained the emotions that he was going through. At that time, at such a young age, like as a young kid, you know, not, you know, fully going through puberty or whatever. Like, he was like, you know, it was just like, man, this was deep for me. So to have him actually break it down like that, I felt like really brought a different emotion out of all of us in that room that, you know, that day. And I remember him. I remember him like, wow, he was here. He was here. I felt it. And so I knew that was going to be the take, even though, you know, even though the other takes were cool, but I knew for certain that was the that was the take he was going to use. He didn't even have to tell me, and I didn't even know. Like, I didn't even know what take he picked, but I knew that was going to be the take. And then I didn't hear it until the record came out, and I was like, oh yeah, that was the one he chose. You know,
this makes me think of a possible reason as to why that helps the musicians come together. And I think because you were mentioning how it made you think of your dad passing, and it brought along a similar thought line. And like, by him saying that, it's something that a lot of people can relate to or have empathy for. And that allows everyone to be on the same wavelength before you record. And otherwise, if you're not on the same wavelength before you record, then people are in different places and thinking about different things, and that kind of brings people together. And it made me think that I remember hearing a story from actually my band director in high school, and he would talk about how when he was playing in this big band one time, what the guy would do, the leader of the band, is they would all like hold hands, kind of like in a prayer. Like thing, and just before the show, and they would all just talk about like what's gonna happen that night.
Right.
And it's a similar thing, I believe. Like, it brings people together. And do you know the story about do you know the record jazz poet Tommy Flanagan?
Yeah.
Do you know the story about behind Mean Streets?
No, I don't.
That's like the really fast one with Kenny Washington playing brushes.
Yeah, so, yeah, yeah.
So he told me the story of how Tommy Flanagan's wife was in the studio, and she was like constantly having input into oh, like, this is not a good take, like, oh, you should redo this, ooh, this and stuff. And that's from what I remember it. And they kept playing different takes of Mean Streets, like, over and over, and it, like, it wasn't working out. She was, like, stopping during the... She was, like, stopping, like, stop, stop.
During the take?
I think that's what...
Oh.
So eventually, I believe it was Kenny, he said, like, enough. Like, this is gonna be the take. And then, like... That and then like he was, because like I think everyone was like kind of getting fed up. They were like we need to just get this song over with. This will be the last take.
Right.
And that's
right.
Like when he did like the amazing drum solo and stuff. And it kind of reminds me of what you were saying. It's like a different line of thought, but it's just like everyone is like kind of aggravated.
Right.
They're all kind of on the same like wavelength. Like, yeah, like, all right, we're gonna do it. And then that was the take.
Yeah. Right. I remember there's a story of a friend of mine, this bass player, Desron Douglas, and he was on this recording session. I can't remember who it was for, but I remember he said, like, yeah, man, you know, he was getting hounded by the leader of the session, like, man, you're messing up the take. And he was getting more and more agitated and frustrated, and because he was just like, man, I'm trying to do my best, man. He was like, I'm getting pissed. You know, he could tell and the guy who was saying, you know, the guy who was on, you know, riding him hard was like, I could tell you're mad at me. You know what? Say F you to me. And he's like, no, I don't want to do it. Because I think it was an older musician. I want to say it was somebody like Michael Carvin or something like that. It was like an older musician who like, I'm not going to disrespect you like that. He's like, no, man, say it. And then, so Desron said, all right, F you, Mr. And they stopped off the tune, and that was the take. You know, like, it was like, you know, that was the take. And, you know, so sometimes, you know, those stories or those, you know, those emotions can really affect how the music is played, you know. And so, you know, sometimes it's anger, or sometimes it's a story that affects how that, you know, that particular moment is processed, or how it plays out. So
yeah, I actually, thinking about that, it's the same idea with I heard this a similar story with that the record of Miles Davis live at Four and More.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And also the My Funny Valentine record that right. They're both live performances, yeah, from the same night. But I don't know if this is true, but I heard from somebody that Miles told them that there was a mess up and they weren't getting paid.
Right, right.
Performance beforehand, and then they were all like playing like super intense.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
After that, so maybe that had something to do with it.
Yeah, I think I heard this story. I think Mr. Carter was saying, Ron Carter was saying, like, I think he kind of pulled Miles aside and said, look, you know, I can't, you know, we can't really ask us to play for free. You know, he was respectful, but I think he was like, look, man, you can't really change this up at the last minute. You know, we have livelihoods, you know, you can't really do that. And I think the understanding was like, I'll walk, you know, like I won't make the gig, you know what I mean? Or something like that. And I think when it got to that, I think Miles, if I'm remembering the story, I think Miles had worked something out so that they were going to be compensated. But it also was like, I think it was because it was so at the 11th hour, I think it created this intensity in the music. And you definitely hear that when, you know, when they sit down and play, it's definitely a different energy. So all those things can come into play, you know, depending on what it is, you know what I mean? You know, I think it's you know, it's amazing how these certain situations can change the outcome of a take or change the overall performance or something, you know. So
is that what you were going for on the 11th hour?
The 11th hour. That actually, for me, it kind of came from for years I kept getting asked to, like, man, you need to put out a record. You need to put out a record. And I was like, man, I don't, you know, I never was in that. I never was of the idea, like, I want to just forcefully put something out. And I just remember kind of waiting till the very last minute to decide to put this record or to record this record. So, so when I, you know, when I went to record it and come up with a title, I was like, well, I waited till the 11th hour to put this out. So we're going to call it the 11th hour.
Really, like, all this talk about feelings, and we were talking a lot about anger here, but mm-hmm. you know, earlier we were talking about loss and mm-hmm. tragedy and all these different things, and Mike, you were talking about like how everybody, how relatable it all is and how we can be empathetic, and something I was thinking about is how much more relatable suffering is than anything else, because not mm-hmm. everybody's gonna get rich. Not everybody's going to be happy but everybody's gonna suffer. Yeah, and we can all empathize with that. But I think.
Well, I was gonna say. I mean, look at what we're going through now. It's like we're all, you know, the playing field has been leveled. You know, we're all on the same. We're all going through the same thing right now.
Yeah.
So, you know. So this is even more important that we try to come together and try to, you know, to think about one another. And because this, you know, I was talking to somebody earlier today. I was like, man, like you said, we're not all going to be rich. And there's some people that are suffering much more than we are, you know.
Yeah.
So it's being able to have that empathy and being able to say, okay, man, is my fellow brother or sister okay? Is everybody okay? Checking in on them. I've been more mindful of that lately, you know, like, you know, even if it's just checking in on my mom or my sisters, like I, you know, sometimes, you know, when things were normal and I was traveling more, I was not that good at like, you know, reaching out to people This is one of the things that I've really been able to take advantage of. It's like, man, when people come to my mind, I got to make it a point to call them. Especially now, like, you know, we're seeing a lot of our heroes die, you know. Like I just got word that another friend of mine passed away. So it's just like, yeah, man, you know, you have to really take advantage of these situations because... you know, life is precious and it can be taken away, you know, like that. So I've been really trying to be more mindful and trying to be better at like reaching out to people and you know, just checking in on them. Like, yo, you need anything? Is everything cool? Like, you know what I mean? Just, you know, there was a friend of mine who was, she was really, you know, like in the beginning of it, she had no means of income. She wasn't making any money. Like she was, you know, almost on the street. So I was like, you know, and somebody had hit me up. He was like, yo, man, you know, our friend is not doing too well. So I just like made it a point to reach out immediately. Give me your PayPal info. I'm going to send you something. You know what I mean? It was what I could do at the time, but it was just like, look, you know, I might be in a better situation than this person is at this time, but, you know, let me try to help them out, you know, because, you know, we have to try to look out for one another and not turn a blind eye, like I was saying earlier about situations, because we never know what people are going through. And I've really been trying to be more mindful of that and be up on it and just say, look, okay. I remember one time there's a neighbor friend of mine who I felt like, you know, he was going through a really bad bout of depression, and I kind of thought, oh man, like he might not, you know, he might try to take himself out. So I remember contacting Jalil. I said, yo, man, I don't want to see this happen. Like maybe we should like try to get together and just invite him to do a session. Maybe that'll change. And I remember doing it. I said, look, and you know, and it came down. The neighbor came over and played, and I could tell that, you know, lifted his mood, you know, it changed his whole outlook on things. Cause I could tell, like, I would see him in the parking lot of our building and I was like, you know, he was like running to get, you know, alcohol at like, you know, 10 a.m. You know what I mean? So I was like, man, you know, something's going on. So I have to really pay attention to this thing and not just ignore it. So, and, you know, so it's just like little things like that. If I, you know, if I can do it or if somebody else can do it, it really can, it can really change a person's attitude on things. So I just try to be as mindful as I can about it.
So generous of you, and I think it also reflects really well on your approach to music that you were saying, like you try to give people something to remember, you try to uplift, you know, it's just kind of part of who you are, so I'm glad to hear this other side of the artist, you know. But also on this topic of suffering and healing, I think that is just one of the most beautiful traditions in our music is just the blues. You know, it's suffering, it's tragedy, it's loss, but it's smiling in the face of it somehow, you know, on all these major chords. And it also makes me think that protest music doesn't have to be dark and luminous. It could be, like, I'm thinking of Nina Simone, I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free, you know. It's, doesn't get more uplifting than these type of songs. Yeah. And the blues as well. We actually had an audience comment earlier that said, when we were talking about Bird, it said, Bird's Now's the Time is protest music. Yeah, so I wanted to ask you about the blues specifically. What is your relationship to the blues, and how do you use that in your playing?
Well, I mean, I think that's the foundation of the music that I play. You know, it's all trenched in the blues and the work songs that you know I knew about and grew up listening to. And so, yeah, for me, the blues is the foundation. And you know, I'm reminded of. This was a couple of years ago now. I went to, I was in D.C. for a weekend playing, and I went to the National African American Museum, you know, the new museum there. And, you know, I was able to go through the whole museum. And, you know, I was reminded about, like, how, you know, those struggles that we went through, but also how... we came out of that and there was some beauty in it. Like, you know, like, so it takes you, like, you know, if you go to the museum, it takes you, like, your, you know, first part, like, when the slaves are being brought over, you know, in these slave ships, and it's, you know, it's really dark, and it's, you know, it's just, you know, deplorable conditions that they're in. But then once you get to the top of this museum, it takes you all the way up to, seeing the inauguration of Obama, and I remember I was with a friend, and I was like, man, it's amazing how we're still able to find the light out of a lot of this oppression that we've been put under. And I think at the root of it is the blues. You know, the blues was first how to communicate with one another, but then it was also you know, it was also used as you know, as, like, you know, for the slaves, like the work songs, it was also used to, like, say, okay, you know, hold on, you know, trains coming or whatever, you know, like these, you know, these things were also, like, kind of codes, like, about, okay, now tonight we're going to escape or whatever, you know. So, but then it also, you know, was like, it was used to convey, like, we made it out, you know, and it was used to convey this sign of freedom and this sign of, you know, we've escaped these dark times. And so, for me, I feel like if the music doesn't have that element in it, then I don't know. It's, to me, it's not, it's like you're missing the key ingredient. It's like, you know, it's like trying to make a cake without, you know, without eggs or you know, or flour, or, you know, or cream. You know, it's not gonna be complete. You know what I mean? So, I mean, unless you're making a vegan cake, but I don't know. I mean, like, you know, but yeah, no. For me, it's like, you know, that is such a key element, and you can't shy away from it if you're playing this music.
Just a short comment. That's like my issue with all these textbooks that say, you know, the blues is this 12 bar form. It starts on the one and it goes to the four. It's just like, that is not even close.
No, man, know, no. Man.
It has nothing to do with bar length. Has nothing to do with dominant chords, you know.
No, and it's a feeling, man.
Yeah,
it's a feeling. It's emotion, and I mean, if you listen to, like, these old blues records of, like, Robert Johnson and not, man, there was no 12 bar. You know, it was just like they were playing, and it was an emotion, and it was like it could be seven bars, it could be 12 bars. It could be 24. You know what I mean? Like, it was just like, no, it was just like they were, you know, they were playing an emotion. They were playing how they felt. And so, and they were playing with the struggles. They were telling you the story. So, you know, the story wasn't regulated to 12 bars, you know, so it was regulated to more of emotion. And I think that's what, you know, what we have to get away from. We have to get away from, like, saying it's just this or, like, it's just what we read in textbook. No, it's about the feeling it gives you and the feeling that you're conveying. Like, if I naturally hear something or I'm naturally playing something, even if I'm writing, I'm not naturally thinking about, oh, this has to be a 12 bar tune or this has to be a 16. I'm playing off of the motion that I'm playing whatever it is. You know, if it's, you know, if it's 12 bar, it's fine. If it's not, it is what it is. But, you know, it's like, you can't really regulate it. It has to, you know, we have to think about more than just the just the theory behind it. We have to think about the emotion and the feeling that we give off. So,
yeah. I'm trying to think of it while you were saying how blues shouldn't be taught, or it shouldn't just be thought of a 12 bar. And I agree. I'm trying to think how it evolved to be taught like that, that it needs those forms. I mean, I think the quick answer is jazz education and just codifying things. And that's that, I guess, overall, that was like the most common example of a blues. But when you say it needs to have certain emotions in it, and it doesn't matter per se, like what the chords are or the measure numbers, what could anything be a blues in that justification, or are there more specific boundaries as to like what defines itself as a blues and what doesn't?
I think there are certain boundaries of what defines blues. There's certain, you know, there's a blues scale, you know what I mean? Like there's, you know, there's a certain, you know, there's certain notes that are played that would outline, you know, like whether it's a minor, you know, minor third or whatever, like it kind of, you know, that kind of structure, kind of dictates if it's a blues. But I think, you know, past that, it doesn't necessarily have to be a certain amount of bar, you know, bars. It just has to have those certain elements in it so that when you hear it, you know, oh yeah, this is a blues. You know what I mean? Like I feel like if it doesn't have those notes that are bended, or, you know, those bended notes, or, you know, to me, like it's not, you know, it could be. And again, like, I mean, there's also some exceptions to the rules. There's also people that write, you know, let's say a 12 bar tune, and then, you know, they might write ahead over some different changes, but then when they go to solo, then they might, you know, they might put it over some blues, put it over a blues, or it might go into a blues. So that's one instance. But there's definitely certain characteristics that make a song a blues, or certain sounds that where you know, like, oh yeah, this is the blues, or, you know, like, you know, it's a different fit, you know, there's a different sound between, you know, when you hear a blues and when you hear a rhythm change, a tune or something like that. You know what I mean? Like there's a difference between it. So there are definitely some, there's exceptions to the rule. I think, you know, for me, I think though, like when I hear like really down home blues, I'm not necessarily thinking about how many, you know, what the bar, how many bars it is. I'm thinking about, oh, how this person is either singing or how he's playing it, or he or she is playing it. You know, how they're bending those notes to make it really feel where you feel that, you know, where you feel it. So, I think that would be my short answer to it, I guess.
It made me think of blues connotation. Do you know that?
Oh, yeah,
that,
yeah.
Yeah, that Ornette Coleman tune. But I bet that.
You're right. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm singing the wrong one. Yeah, it's like da boop ba da ba da ba da da ba da ba da. Yeah. And there's like one extra, I think a 2/4 measure.
2/4 measure, right? Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Ornette was a great genius. Song. I love his composing, man. I love his writing. Yeah.
Well, Johnathan, thank you so much for being so giving with your time. We're almost at 2 hours here.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Dang. Yeah. We are. Wow, yeah. I didn't even know that.
There were some more audience questions that we got during the course of this conversation. Moved on. I didn't want to interrupt for those, but I do want to come back around to them. Let's see here. You had some compliments and shout-outs from Janice Reedus. And then...
Nisi.
And then the handle wheeljacked9311 has a couple of questions for you.
Sure.
I think we can combine them because they're dealing with similar things. The first was, how can we as musicians introduce new and younger audiences to jazz bop without overwhelming them with complexity? I'm struggling to find the balance between progressing the art and maintaining tradition. It's kind of like another question too. The next question is, this is when we were talking about listening habits and technology. Mm-hmm. Do our methods for storytelling through music need to adapt to the audience, skipping around, as many people listen using streaming services? So I think the message is like, how do we get our music out there more to newer, younger audiences in general with the streaming services and youth being all these different factors?
Yeah, I mean, I think part of it is going back to what we were saying earlier, making, you know, thinking about the melody I kind of know, like, if the tune is working when I'm in the car and listening and my kids start singing the melody and I'm like, oh, okay. So, you know, like there's a tune that I wrote recently, and whenever I'm in the car, my son starts singing it immediately. And I'm like, okay, maybe this is cool. So I think, and he's 13. So he's listening to whatever he hears on the radio and things like that. But I think if it's melodic and you expose them to that, I think it's something that sits with them. So even if I'm not playing the song, like, he'll think about it when he's in the car because that conveyed a certain emotion to him. So I think that's one of the things. I also think I'm really big on exposing kids at an early age to music, you know, and really trying to introduce it to them when they're young. Before they start forming their own ideas about what's good and what's not, you know. I try to expose kids to music at an early age. The other way is also sometimes playing a song that they might know, like playing a Taylor Swift song or something like, but putting my own stamp on it. There's a tune that I play. I think it's off of the Trion record. It's a tune by The Police called Synchronicity, right? And I remember when we first played that tune, like, people were going crazy. And some people didn't even know what it was, but it was just something that, like, They it sounded familiar to them, and they could relate to it. So, so I think that's also one way to bring people into it, kind of playing songs that they might be familiar with, and putting your own arrangement on it. I have a new record coming out in I think in a few months with a band that I've been playing with, and one of the tunes we do is an arrangement that I wrote on a Joe Jackson composition called Stepping Out, which is from like the 80s. But I remember when we were playing it at the Vanguard, when I premiered my group at the Vanguard, man, there was people just singing it right away. And, you know, and then people were like, man, I recognize that tune, but I can't remember the name of it. You know, and it was just like, so sometimes just doing those little things that not necessarily like where you're playing down to people, but you're giving them something that they can kind of relate to will kind of draw them in naturally. And they'll want to hear more, you know what I mean? Because you've sparked their curiosity. And that's the thing with, like, you know, I think with kids, when you expose it to them and it sparks a certain curiosity. I mean, you're not going to be able to reach everybody, but, you know, you'll definitely reach them. Like, if you spark that, you know, if you spark that curiosity in them, they're hopefully going to seek it out more. So, so I think those are some of the ways you could do it.
I love that answer because it's very pragmatic and practical, but, you know, very effective. But I also wanted to add about playing covers is it can put you where you are as an artist in the context of our history and our culture, you know, like, and mm-hmm. it shows things that you've been checking out and you're aware of. It's, like you said, it's not just playing down to people. And I think a lot of times when young musicians like ourselves are composing, like, we try so hard to avoid genre, we try hard to be original, and we try to break new ground and make the next killing thing, and we like avoid the influences and the genres that that we've listened to and the context that we come from. It's like, no, invite people into it. This is my lineage, you know.
Exactly. I'm from the mindset, look, man, there's only two types of music. It's either good or bad, and if it affects you a certain way, then why not incorporate it? You know, like, I mean, think about like Miles Davis incorporating Time After Time. You know, it was something that he liked. He liked that song. He liked the melody, so he liked to play it. So why not incorporate it for the band that you're playing? I mean,
by Cyndi Lauper, the
time. Yeah. He used to play that like in the mid '80s, maybe even early like '80s. Yeah, he covered that.
Well, and jazz artists cover tunes all the time with jazz standards. Referencing the past.
Yeah, so I mean, like for me, it's like if it speaks to you, then why not include it? You know what I mean? So I don't think you should shy away from it. Just because, you know, it might be like, oh, you're selling out. No, it's like, no, man, I like this. I like this affects me. This brings a certain emotion to me, and I want to be able to share that with you. So even like, you know, even like my arrangement on that Joe Jackson tune. We have time. I can play it for you a little bit, just so you can hear a little bit of it. Is there a way I can play it?
Yes, please. You just have to share your computer sound.
All right.
I have to enable
it. You gotta make me a host, right?
Yes, one moment. Okay, yeah, you should be good for that.
Okay. So, yeah, let me share the computer sound. I'll just play a little bit of it. I won't play the whole thing, but
sure.
But is this gonna be on the record?
Yeah, this I'll play you.
Oh, a sneak peek.
Yeah, a little sneak preview.
Awesome.
Can you guys hear it?
Yeah. Thank you. Beautiful.
But, you know, but like taking that from, let me see if I can find the actual tune. Bear with me for 1 second. You know, it was a tune that I grew up listening to. I just loved the tune. And I said, man, you know, why not do it? It's something that speaks to me, so why not play it? But this is the actual tune.
Oh my God. Wow.
Right? So, you know, for me, it's like, let me stop sharing. It's like, man, if it conveys a certain emotion to you, then why not share it? And a lot of times, like, you know, people recognize it and it sparks their curiosity and they want to hear more. So I think that's, you know, that's a way to kind of draw more people in to your music.
Yeah. Have you heard of the band? Well, it's not a band. It's a DJ. Girl Talk.
Yeah.
I never heard the original song, but I forget which song that he used that, but that was like the main riff for one of his songs, and I loved that. Was like one of my favorite songs he did, and then I just thank you for showing me that. Check that out.
Yeah, that's a great too. I mean, like you know, there's been a couple people who've also done covers. It's just, I don't know. For me, I remember when I first, sent the arrangement, I hadn't had it recorded. So when I sent it to the band, I just sent the actual Joe Jackson version. And I remember getting an email from the band. By the way, is going to be that you heard is Emmanuel Wilkins playing alto, Joel Ross on vibraphones, David Varelis on piano, and Desron Douglas playing bass.
So the same group that was playing My Life Matters project.
Almost, with the exception of Dana Stevens. Well, actually, no, it is quite different because Dana's in the My Life Matters band. So is Fabian Amazon and Rashawn Carter. So it's a slightly different band, and different music, of course. But I remember like bringing that tune, that arrangement to the band, and the first person who hit me up was Desron. He was like, "Yo, man, that brought me back. That brought me back to, you know," I started having these like flashbacks of where I was at that time when I heard that song. And so, you know, sometimes it kind of takes that to invite people in. You know, you have to give them something that they can latch onto or something that sparks a memory so that they can kind of come along with you on the journey and spark the curiosity of what, you know, of learning more about the individual that they heard. So
did Emmanuel Wilkins or Joel Ross know about the song?
No, they probably weren't even born when that song came out.
I don't think they were.
20 years younger than us, well, like, or at least for me. I mean, Joel was, I think Joel was 25, and Manuel might even be younger. So they
had to go
where
there,
that right? was. Oh, of course, they had no clue where that song was coming from. But at the same time, they were, you know, they're the type of musicians that want to learn. So I hit them to it. I was like, "Yo, check out where the original of it." And you know, and they were like, "Oh man, this is hip." You know, and then when they heard the arrangement that I brought to them, they were like, "Man, I love what you did with it. I really like how you know took it and made it your own." So,
Yeah, exactly. You really made it your own with that arrangement, and I think it could be easy sometimes to take, or it's definitely a challenge to take like a more pop oriented tune like that and to make it one's own. And it really struck me as like, wow, like you really put a different twist on this tune, because sometimes it's easy to just make it like a lesser version of the original.
Right.
You know, sometimes like when I make covers of things, like I'm just like, oh, like why would people want to listen to this over the original?
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So I think before we went in to record, I was, or even before we went to play, I had this idea in my head of like, man, I'm hearing this slow way down, kind of like a, you know, almost like a slow Brazilian thing in three. And it was funny though, because even though it's really different from the original, I remember when we played it at the Vanguard, right away people knew what it was just from those, you know, just from those triad chords in the beginning. They knew right away, like, oh, you know, they might not remember the name, but it was just like, and that's kind of what I wanted to convey. I was like, man, this is about, you know, this is about really trying to bring more people in and include them in our story that we're telling. So sometimes there's ways to do that by, you know, playing something that they're familiar with.
It was funny for me listening to that. You know, there was like a split second of like, oh, who's the alto player? And then there was like, it just like, it was like, oh, that's Emmanuel. And it's so crazy to me that he's like, you know, he's like a year older than me or something like that. And he already has that identifiable of a sound. And I haven't gotten a chance to listen to his new records yet or anything like that. Mm-hmm. But it was just, it's already that personal.
No, I mean, it's amazing. Both him and Joel, I mean, how they've really, you know, how they play so, you know, so beyond the years to me. Like they sound so mature for their age. I was watching an Instagram interview yesterday that Joel was doing with Christian McBride for the Newport Jazz Festival page, and I kind of forgot how old he was because he plays so mature. And when he said 25, I was like, oh, damn it! You know, like I would just like slap this cat. You know, like it's just amazing, like how, you know, how amazing they both sound. But I think also it goes to like what we were talking about. They really engross themselves in the music, and they really try to listen to everything and really listen. Like they'll sit down and listen to a record. I think the first time I actually hired them for a gig, I forget what there was one tune that we were playing and I think Emmanuel was mentioning like, man, I've never heard Kenny Garrett play soprano saxophone. And I was like, man, you never heard this record called Hand in Hand by Mulgrew Miller? And he'd never heard of that record. So I was like, right away, I was like, all right, dude, I'm going to send this to you tonight. I want you to. And he checked it out immediately. And he was like, and I remember that I think we were playing two nights. And the next night, I could tell he had been checking it out because the way he approached playing the song, even though he was playing alto on this particular, the way he approached it was like, oh, okay. Yeah, he gave a listen to it. You know what I mean? So, and I remember, I mean, from an early age, I mean, I remember Emmanuel's parents bringing him to shows that I was doing in Philly at a very young age. So he's always been exposed to music at a very young age, but also just engrossed himself in it and just continues to listen to this day. And is also open to, like, you know, just learning about, you know, things he doesn't know. Like, you know, he doesn't try to act like he's above it. You know, he is always like, he's still a student like all of us. So, you know, and I think that's why it comes through in his mind.
I was thinking about this video you posted of you guys playing Eddie Harris's Crying Blues. Right?
Mm-hmm. I saw that. That was a great video.
It is.
Oh, thanks.
Super killing. But Eddie Harris, to me, he's just like a bit of an unsung hero of like all these things we're talking about. Just incredible groove and like soul and good feelings and like Mean Greens and the In Sounds.
Oh, yeah.
Billy Higgins and like.
Oh, man.
It's just some of the best stuff. So, has Eddie Harris, obviously you covered his tune, but Has he also been somebody who's been important to you?
Oh, totally, man. Totally. You know, we go back to playing the blues. I mean, his music is all drenched in the blues. You know what I mean? Like, you know what I mean? It's in the South. Crying blues, but cold duck time. You know, like, I'm thinking about posting maybe tomorrow I might post that. I did a version of that a couple weeks ago with Chris Potter. And Chris is another one who was really influenced by Eddie Harris. A lot of people don't know.
Really?
Yeah. Like, if you listen, I think on his first record, there's a tune that he, or not his first record, but his first record for, I guess it was Verve or something like this. I think there's a tune that he dedicated to
Eddie Harris. Talking about Gratitude?
Gratitude. Right? Isn't there a tune on there?
If it's on any album, it's going to be on that one.
Yeah, I think there's a tune that he dedicated to Eddie Harris. But I mean, no, I think, you know, Eddie for me was a really big influence because he really incorporated the blues, but he also incorporated, you know, kind of the elements of funk and rock in his playing. And it just, you know, you just, when you hear him play it, it seems so seamless the way he put it all together. And it's, you know, like you said, it's down home, it's greasy, but it's also like, it's a good time, man. It just makes you feel good. And I remember even when I posted that video, like, a lot of comments were like, man, this feels so good, you know, because it was like, you know, that's, for me, that's what I got out of his music, and that's what I wanted to convey when I play those tunes. Like, I wanted to feel good, you know. You know, finding that right, that groove, that sweet spot in the tempo where it's going to make you bop your head. You can't help but just to dance or get up and move. So, you know, for me, he was definitely a big influence. And you're right, he was definitely an unsung hero, man. I mean, I wish more people would talk about him because he was such an important figure in this music that we play. So,
Mike, have you heard The In Sound?
Yeah, I used to listen to that record a lot, actually.
Man.
Yeah, that was a very, very grooving record.
Oh, yeah.
My favorite was The Shadow of Your Smile on there.
That was the first track off of the record, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then they had Freedom Jazz Dance. That was the last
record.
Right. Higgins, and he was doing, like, such a, like, so, yeah, no,
so different than the Miles recording.
Right.
Oh, this wasn't this like pointillistic, like counterpoint. This was just groove.
It was pocket. It was all about the pocket. Yeah, you know, and you know, Billy Higgins was a master of like finding that pocket and that groove and tunes like that. So yeah.
Also the what's that tune? Da da da.
Love for Sale.
Oh, Love for Sale.
Oh, Love. Yeah, they do like a super fast version of Love for Sale. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's, yeah.
Yeah,
that's the biggest thing on there is the groove, just with
Ron
Carter and Billy Higgins.
Ooh,
and
that's a dream team right there, man. The way they hook up is like, ooh, yeah, you can't go wrong. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to talk about feeling good, but that's some feel good music for you, man. Like, I always go back to that, you know. Because, you know, it's finding those things that kind of, you know, when you talk about, like, getting out of your, you know, getting out of the day-to-day life stuff that's, you know, like, bugging you or whatever, sometimes you can put on those records and it just, like, transports you somewhere else. And, I remember that, you know, having those experiences and still having them to today. And I remember, when I was picking the music for that particular gig I did with Emmanuel and Dezron in Philly. Man, when I said, oh man, I want to play Crying Blues, I immediately went back to the recording just to feel how like, oh, like, man, this groove is so killing that they're playing. Like, I just love the way this feels. Like, it just, you know, it just, you know, brought me back to why I wanted to play it in the first place. So,
you also have such a reference, like, I hear in your playing, you have such a strong, like, groove when it comes to, like, Latin music, like Brazilian groove, and I heard, even on Good Hope
from
the Trion record, that's more like a calypso
Yeah, kind of like an Afrobeat calypso type of vibe.
Yeah, like dude, yeah. Like kind of like yeah, that. Yeah. Yeah, like what? Where did you get those influences from? Because I and even on the last track you played from your new record, that was more very like Brazilian inspired.
Yeah, I mean, I think for me it's just like I was saying earlier. I just always was listening to different types of music, and I really fell in love with Brazilian music years ago. Like one of my favorite artists is this vocalist Rosa Passos. She's just unbelievable. If you ever get a chance to check her out, oh man, she transports me every time I hear her. I got to see her live twice. I remember one time I had just come back from Japan or something like that, and found out that she was playing in Montclair, New Jersey, at this small club in Montclair, New Jersey called Trumpets.
Oh, okay.
Like, oh, we gotta go. I was jet lagged like a mug, but I was like, I gotta see this. And then it was just so beautiful. It was almost like seeing her live. It was almost like, because this place is so small, it was almost like her being in my living room and performing a private concert, because there was only like 7 or 8 people in the audience. And it was just a beautiful thing, you know. So she's definitely one of my favorites. And so, I just get inspired by, I try to listen. And like I said, like, I try to listen to everything all the way through, whatever albums I get. Another person is the singer Dori Kayami. Who's another amazing Brazilian composer and also vocalist, and I think he plays guitar or keyboard. But he has a record that I really love called, I think it's called Kicking Cans or something like that. And I think Branford's on that. And it's just, man, it's such a beautiful record. And that's another one. So I think for me to, when I approach playing those tunes, it's like I revert back to the things that have influenced me and the things that I listen to. You know, I always tell people, like, when I was growing up, like, my teachers weren't teaching me just to be a jazz drummer. They were teaching me to be a drummer, and which means that you play and engross yourself in all different styles, because you never know who's going to call you on the other end. You know, if Santana or somebody calls you, you're not going to be like, oh yeah, I don't really play that music. You're like, oh no, I play that. You know, like, you really want to, you want to engross yourself. So for me, it was like, yes, I love jazz music, but I was also influenced by other types of music. And for me, it's like when I sit down to play those songs, I just try to think of the mood and the vibe and the groove that I get when I hear it myself, as a listener, and try to convey that in my playing when I play these tunes.
Yeah, beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Are we all through with these
questions? More questions?
There was one more about protest music, actually.
Okay.
The question was, do you sit down with the intent to write music in protest, or is it realized later?
No, I don't sit down and have a preconceived idea about, I might have, maybe I've read something or seen something, and maybe subconsciously, when I go to sit down and I write the music, and then after I hear it, I'm like, oh man, that kind of reminds me of that. That whole My Life Matters, when I first wrote the tunes and I brought it into rehearsal, there were no names on the tunes. It just said Commission 1, Commission 2, Commission 3, Commission, like, it had no title, because I wasn't, the only thing I was thinking about was like, it was stuff that I was seeing. I was like, man, there's so much injustice, especially at the hands of the people that are put in charge to serve and protect us. That's, that was kind of the thing that was rolling around my head, but it wasn't like I was sitting down to write this. It was just like, I wrote this music, and then after it was finished, I was like, oh, well, let me really sit down and listen to it. And I remember I remember sitting at my dining room table with my kids, and we just listened to the rehearsal. And that's where the titles would, like, you know, I was, you know, like, the first movement is called Last Breath. I think that might have been the first tune we listened to. Oh, no. Maybe it was something else we listened to. And then I was like, oh, that kind of reminds me of this. Or, you know, so it wasn't like I was, like, sitting down like, yeah, I got to write some protest music. It was like, I was just like, no, I was writing and, you know, it was whatever was coming to me was just coming to me. And then after I listened to it, I was like, man, I guess I was being influenced by what I was seeing, and then I kind of just put the names to it afterwards.
Wow.
So, no, I don't necessarily sit down with the preconceived idea of, like, I'm going to write a protest song, or I don't know. Like, I feel like when you do that, then it kind of automatically puts the song in a certain vibe and or has a certain energy to it, and I feel like it has to come more organically. Like, I don't want to really have any kind of preconceived idea of what is going to come. I just want it to come, and for me, it's like as a composer, it's like sometimes there's like a lot of droughts. Like, you know, even now, like, I feel like there's been so much drought. Because I don't want to force it. I don't want to have preconceived. I just want to be able to sit down and say, oh, this is a melody I have in my head. Let me see if I can expand on it or see where it takes me. You know, so I think for me, when you come to it in that way, I think it's more connected. And then I think it also connects with the audience even more, you know, so.
Makes me wonder if Alabama was played or composed and then titled afterward in the same way.
Maybe so. You know, maybe so. Maybe when he heard, you know, when he listened back to the take and how he was playing the song, you know, like, you know, maybe I was like, maybe later on that invoked him. And it was like, oh, man. This is kind of, you know, this is kind of the mood I'm feeling with this. And this is what's, you know, maybe this is what affected me when I heard about the bombing, or when I saw the photos and news. You know, I don't know. You know, we don't know. We'll never know. But, you know, maybe so.
Mm-hmm. So. Mike, did you have anything to end with?
Well, other than just how this has been a very open conversation, and I got to really know you, Mr. Blake, a lot better. I always enjoy having these and getting to talk to the artists I admire, and it's just awesome conversation to hear your perspective on things and your outlook on life, and I get to just have a conversation.
Man, I appreciate it, man.
Oh, thank you for that.
No, it's my pleasure, man. Thank you for asking me to be a part of this. This is really beautiful, and I thank you for also both of you and Austin, not shying away from the topic that I wanted to talk about. I really appreciate you guys being open enough to keep the line of conversation open, because I think that's an important step to what, you know, what we need to do to get our message across, and you know, having that open dialogue, and not, you know, and having maybe those uncomfortable conversations are very important to create any kind of change. So I appreciate you, Michael, and I appreciate you, Austin, for having me tonight. As you can see, we can go on forever, but I appreciate you guys being open and having me tonight. It's been a real joy to talk to you guys. Thank you.
No, I appreciate you being such a generous being and man. You know, it's you didn't come in with any. It's clear that you didn't come in with an agenda or anything. You just wanted to have a talk about what's going on and what you think about in your art and all these things. And it's just nothing but enlightening. So we tend to. end these calls with a 90-second question round of very simple, short answer questions that are not so serious.
Okay, cool. Go ahead, fire away.
So I'm going to start a timer. You mind coming up with the first one, Mike?
Sure.
All right. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
What's your favorite sandwich?
I love a good turkey club. Turkey and cheddar. Goes down all the time.
What is the best or worst pickup line that you know?
Hey, I'm Jonathan Blake.
Best or worst, depending on the girl, I guess.
Exactly.
Pineapple on pizza, yes or no?
No, man. Not at all.
What is your go-to deli order?
Italian sub. I love that. Yeah. Or I grew up in Philly, so either a Italian hoagie or a cheesesteak. I love that.
If you could bring one item on an island, what would it be?
One item on an island. Wow. I guess it would be a record player and a couple records.
Yeah. Tell me you're from Philly without saying you're from Philly.
That's the John. The John. JAWN. If you say that, everybody knows immediately. Oh, we know where you're from.
What was the last movie you watched?
The last movie I watched was Soul. The anime cartoon with John Batiste and Angela Bassett.
All right.
And Jamie Foxx.
Yeah, and don't forget Linda Oh on that
and
soundtrack.
Linda Oh and Marcus Gilmore and Tia Fuller.
Roy Haynes, too.
And Roy Haynes was on it, yeah. And Questlove, another Philly homie. So, I mean, it's amazing. And I'm so happy to see the awards that they've all been nominated for. It's just a beautiful thing. I thought it was really well done. So, yeah.
All right. Well, that's our 90 seconds once again.
All right.
Thank you so much, Johnathan Blake, for
my pleasure.
The 90 seconds and the 2 hours and all the wisdom. We learned a lot.
Oh, my pleasure, man. Thanks so much for listening and chatting with me. I appreciate it, guys.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Thank you to everybody listening live. And all, you, Johnathan, you'll get to see later. There's a few, but some really nice comments for later. But
Okay, cool.
All right. Good night, everyone. Thank you so much.
Good night. Thank you.